So we are in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 17. Let's start called Guess the Word That Larry's Thinking Of is the name of this game.
Stress.
Stress is good. I like that. Everything causes stress. Everything causes
pain.
Pain. Chaos.
Something.
Emotions. Yeah. Have you bought anything recently that has a warning label on it from the state of California? Yeah, everything causes cancer.
Oh.
The California warning labels, you know, are just kind of one of these, really? One of those kind of crazy things.
Oh, I'm sorry.
On how this works. I don't know. We're all good. So, with this idea about everything causes cancer, you know, we live in a world that's by nature, by our own nature, fallen and broken. And this is one of these things to think through here as we get into what I call the meat of this passage. Verse 17 is a hard passage for me. It's a hard verse for me. Because to me it seems to contradict what Jesus said before he went back to heaven and left this planet. He said to the disciples, make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. It's called part of the Good Commission. Go forth into all the world, make disciples and baptize them. Paul goes just the opposite here. And here's what Paul says. Christ did not send me to do what?
But to preach the gospel.
Yeah. This is what bothers me. Why does Paul get an exemption? Because if you have a really good answer for that, I have a really big question that needs answering. Is the statement that Jesus made to the disciples to go into all the world, make disciples, and baptize them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost. Baptize them for the remission of sins. Is that universal? Or is that just for the 11 guys that were there that day? Anybody want to take a stab at that dilemma?
I think maybe Paul thought it was just for the 11 guys that were there.
So if Paul thought that that was just for the 11 guys that were there, should we also think that?
Should be universal, but he's thinking that I need to tell these guys to get them to understand this is the way it is.
Okay. HL, I think I kind of lean on how you articulated that. I'm going to go on a crazy train here for just a second. Things can be universal and simultaneously specific. I have no problem with the Good Commission being a universal commission. Okay. There's also a part of the Good Commission where I think that we as people decide to take that personally or not. Am I called as a Christ believer to go out and make disciples and to do these things? If I'm not, what am I called to do? See, the argument in the Corinthian church here is that who baptized whom? Okay. Well, the argument here is, this is a disagreement here that's going on. I follow Apollos, I follow Cephas, I follow Christ. Is Christ divided? No, Christ is not divided. And when Paul says, I thank God that I didn't baptize any of you, now he's clarifying it. This verse 17 is hard for me as a pastor. Maybe hard for me as a pastor is different. It's something that I wrestle with as a pastor, because watch what he says here. He said, but to preach the gospel, there are two knots. There are two knots on how he preaches, okay? What are the two knots on how he does this?
Not with wisdom, not with eloquence.
Not with wisdom, not with eloquence. I have pastor friends visiting with some of my pastor friends here in the last week. One of them was telling me, Larry, you're really organized, and I can tell you just about any sermon, what's coming up on any given Sunday from now to the end of 2017. I've got my sermons planned out. I do that every September. And somebody made the mention to me that, well, because you plan stuff so far out that the Holy Spirit doesn't have a chance to work, to which I said, I think you're wrong. Just me personally, I think Holy Spirit can work in planning just as much as he can living on the fly. Okay? Had another pastor friend that I was visiting with said, I have about four verses that I walk into the pulpit with and nothing's written. Wow. He said, I completely fly by the seat of my pants when it comes to preaching. And it's like, okay. Now here's, so visiting with some of my preacher friends, it's like, oh, holy cow, there's different thoughts about how it is that we do this thing called preaching. And I think that it's, if I would have to try to say, this is how I want to do it, this is why this verse, I wrestle with this verse, okay? We talked a little bit last week about the whole Joel Osteen thing, about how he picks up, this is my Bible and this whole thing. How do I say this? If you've ever listened to preachers, or for those of you who do listen to preachers on the radio or on TV and watch and do this thing, man, some of them sound really good. And I had a chance to go to a Billy Graham crusade a number of years ago. If you'd like to give your life to Jesus, we got some rooms over here on the side. And so just kind of go on over there. And I was sitting by a guy in this thing. I said, hi, I'm Larry. He said, hi. And he told me, I don't remember his name. I said, tell me why you're here. He said, there's somebody sitting in each section that we all go up and go into that room, so that somebody else will follow us into that room. That feels like cheating. So when you've ever seen a Billy Graham crusade or something like that, and you see all these people getting up and going into this other section, he said, we're told to do that. Number one, because other people follow us, because that's how the human body and brain work. He said, number two is, we're already there, and we've already gone through a training to sit there and visit with people who are coming into that room. So it's like the first half, are people who are going in there to talk to people, and the second half are the people who are going in there to talk to somebody else. It's like that's wise. Okay, now in all this craziness, somewhere this is how Paul says he does it. Not with wisdom, not with eloquence. Which means that dumb and boring shouldn't be an excuse. Because I don't think he's saying be dumb and boring. I try to really make sure that I'm not boring, even if on some days I'm not the brightest, okay? However, I want you to watch how Paul is building this argument. Because we have come through, because we as a culture in the United States have come through this, let's see here. It's been 10, 12 days ago, something like that. Anybody watch Trump during the election cycle? And have you ever listened to some of his speeches? And how did, let me ask this question, how did those make you feel? Or what did those make you think?
Sometimes I would wonder if he ever thought about what he was going to say before he uttered it.
Yeah.
Because
It just kind of comes out, doesn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Other things that you saw in the election cycle, in the campaign way of campaign mode is basically what I'll call it. Any observations?
I think Hillary probably thought of everything she was going to say and had it written down and just...
Yeah. Did anybody here watch the State of the Union address? Okay, a couple of us. What'd you think about the State of the Union address? It was a lot more eloquent, wasn't it?
Mean what you say what you mean.
But there was a change between the campaign Donald Trump and the State of the Union address Donald Trump. Okay? It was kind of one of those things where it's like, oh, this is different. The commentator for the station that I was watching this on said, this may be the best State of the Union address he had ever heard. And for a liberal TV journalist to say that was rather strange. It's like, oh, like, you know, regardless of where you're at on the whole political issue, it was just rather strange to hear that. Here's what's going on. He says, I'm called to preach, not to baptize. I'm called to preach the gospel, not with wisdom and eloquence, lest what?
Christ.
Yes. The cross of Christ would be
emptied of power.
This is a bracket. I know you can't. It looks more like a tenor clef than anything else, and I apologize. That's just kind of how it happened. My shoe came untied. It's annoying me. when we use wisdom and when we use eloquence, when we say, oh, hey, you know what? There's a room over here and we're going to have people in there to talk to you, and the people who are sitting by you in your section get up and go in there. It looks like power. And I think that verse 17 here is saying this. You don't have to be wise. You don't have to be eloquent. Because it's not about us. If you've ever been in a conversation with somebody about spiritual things, okay? And you may feel yourself, oh my goodness, I'm fumbling over my words. And oh my goodness, I don't, boy, I really wasn't the smartest thing to say. And holy cow, I wonder if I got that wrong. Okay? Here's the thing, is don't worry about this. Because it's not you that's doing it. It's God, exactly. You see, here's how Paul says it. That the cross and its power is greater than his preaching ability. And this is something that I've been this verse, I wrestle with this verse. I think to some extent our church, and maybe churches in general, need to wrestle with this verse. Yes, sir.
I'm just going to bring this up, but I was with Bill yesterday, and he was to that fire.
Uh-huh.
And there's this white cross out there in the hill. I know where it's at. I've seen it. It's over by Buffalo.
Okay.
He's got a picture of that. It's burnt all around this cross. But there's probably 50 foot all around this cross that's not burnt.
That's strange.
Yes.
My mom's neighbor, when they had that Mother's Day fire out of Critch, she had a cross out in her yard that the neighbor had a cross in the yard going all around it, but it didn't touch
the cross. That picture's amazing. It is. I mean, I can believe that one.
That's the picture.
Yeah.
Well, I've seen that cross. I mean, it's amazing to me.
Where's that?
It's over by Buffalo.
It's really awesome. It's over by Buffalo.
May have to have you say that and send it to me. What? Awesome.
You know, Larry, that's pretty much goes along right along with the thought of being an elder, serving as an elder in the church, and calling up individuals within the church. It's not so much you're going to be there to know so much, you can tell them.
Yeah.
Deep wisdom and
elders.
That's what you really need to look out of.
Oh, yeah, I see it.
Kind of guide you.
Yeah. Yeah, and this is, see, and I want to make sure that I want to make sure that this is something that we get in our grasp of, okay? It is not the, I want to try to say this.
Sorry.
No, thank you. It is not the edifice of the cross that matters, okay? We'll wait for a second because we still got pictures going around.
I just tagged her in.
That's Jesus. Oh, sorry, I didn't give him his beard. Now we got Jesus. Yeah, he did. Jesus was a Hasidic Jew. I don't know. He is. This is how we've drawn Jesus for a long time. You know. So, I want you to consider this. Okay, it's not the edifice. It's not the actual. There's nothing magical about a cross, but we think there is. How many of you may have crossed ladies? You may have crossed jewelry with a cross on it, things like that. This is what bothers me about that. This is just your pastor's hang up. I used this illustration once. It got me in great trouble. I'm about ready to use it again. Okay, good. Renee will share it with us.
No, I'm just saying, be prepared. He was honest. He said it's a hang up, so. You want to know the story, don't you?
If we wore one of the, some of you don't know what this is. If some of us wore this around our neck, you'd be perceived as, like, you're pretty weird. But understand that the cross was a method of execution. The cross is a method of execution. If we were to do this, if you were to start making electric chair jewelry, and you go to Zales, you say, hey, I'm looking for a necklace with a nice little golden electric chair on it. Or if your kids or grandkids came up and said, you know what, Mom, Dad, I want a necklace that has a little gold guillotine on it. That would be creepy weird. That would be creepy weird. But there's a difference between these two things and the cross. You see, what was odd for the early church is that they gloried in the cross. They took the thing that they would go in and out of town with. And on the edge of town along the highways, Roman soldiers would have people crucified there for various crimes, insurrections. It was a pretty regular thing. Don't do this. And they took that and they made it something to glory in. That somehow I might be called to give my life for what I believe. And the cross, or the symbol of the cross, and the cross of Christ got venerated that way. Here's, follow this out here with what Paul says here. The message of the cross is foolishness to those who are what? You really get down to it. Here's how crazy the gospel sounds. You can go to heaven if you believe a guy who was put to death by the Roman government, who came back to life. If you believe all that, you get to go to heaven. Now, while I'm saying we may believe that, does that not sound like you're a little wacko in the head? Have you ever really thought about the essence of your faith at some point in time gets a little wacko? Your thought? Am I the only one?
Even to go along with what you're saying, just to have normal conversations with people who have no faith and we have faith, they can't understand. Someone has a crisis and you try to share with them and I guess the word minister to them, mm-hmm. and tell them maybe, yeah, I've had this crisis, but this is how Christ brought me through it. That is just as, it's just as foolish to them, because they look at you like you're crazy.
Right.
I mean, they're like, because it's like we're talking another language. It's like I'm talking Spanish to them. If they don't speak Spanish, they don't understand anything.
Yeah.
Nor do they care to, and they're just like, that's nuts. That's crazy.
Yeah. Here's one of the best way, here's one of the best way to try to illustrate some of this craziness here. There's a book of cults that I've had for a number of years. One was the cult of Bubba Free John. You've probably never heard of the church or the cult of Bubba Free John. But basically John, this guy who everybody called, believe it or not, Bubba, just said, you know what, we can be free to do whatever we want to. And he kind of created his own little thing, Bubba Free John. That's strange. A couple years ago, one that came out is the floating, is the invisible floating spaghetti monster in the sky, I think. That everything that you can attribute to God in the Christian world, you can also attribute to an invisible floating spaghetti monster in the sky. That this invisible floating spaghetti monster in the sky somehow is in control of everything. Now, when I say that, does there not a part of you say you people are nuts? And they look at people who believe in Jesus as, you guys are completely nuts. There is a movement here that we need to also understand. Atheism is kind of this thing that is a little strange. A is in not theism, there is no God. Let's see if I can do this well. There's ideas here that, well, atheism, these people say that there is no God, okay? It's really strange because you can't prove something from the negative. Logically, you can't prove something from the negative. So saying that there's not something obviously means that there is something there for there not to be. Strange thing is, in the academic world, this actually moves away from atheism into anti-theism. So it's not good enough just to believe that there is no God. You have to be against everybody who does believe in God. And I want you to catch this. There is a lot of the world today in this anti-theism part. Take a look at the gospel message, this cross of Christ, and say, you know what, you guys are stupid. It is absolutely incomprehensible. This whole idea that a Jewish guy who died on a cross by the hands of Roman soldiers and somehow walked away from it and came out of a hole in the ground, that sounds crazy.
Could it be that's why they're perishing? Because they don't believe, they can't understand that?
I think that's exactly the case in how Paul is wording this. Is that we're perishing, but we don't know it. Follow what I'm trying to say? Here's the difference. The people who got on the Titanic, most of the people who got on the Titanic expected that trip to go without incident. They were actually dying and didn't know it. When water starts coming up from the bottom, they're dying, and guess what? They do know it. They can see the water coming. And when you are dying and you can see the water coming, guess what you start looking for? A life raft. A way out. A way of salvation. And this whole idea here in this, how I try to explain this, is that at some point in time, we're all dying, okay? We are all dying.
We're born to die.
Yeah. We, you know, death is a process. It starts with life. And guess what? Sometimes you realize it, sometimes we don't. It's when we start realizing that, holy cow, I'm dying and there's no way out of this, that creates a pretty big need for a Savior at that point in time. So, here it is. And the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to those who are being saved, for those of us who are being saved, you follow how, remember how we talked about status and state last week? Tell me about being. What are we being? How many of you are being Oklahoma fans or being OSU fans? Are you being that? Follow Trump? You am one. Okay, I like that. You are in a state of being, right? An OU fan or an OSU fan. And you are all, if somebody were to say, well, she was an OU fan, there's a past tense to it. This is really strange in the English. Watch how this is, being is present. Saved is what?
Past
tense. You are constantly past tense. You are actively state, being saved, status. We are constantly, this is a hard thing. We are constantly being saved. The job has already been done, but we are constantly in the process of it. Just pick up on that subtlety somewhere in here. It is the power of God. Watch what goes on here next. I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, the intelligence of the intelligent I will frustrate. Where is the wise person? Where is the teacher of the law? Where is the philosopher of this age? Let me ask these questions here. Describe to me this guy.
He knows everything.
Dr. Phil. Yeah. You do or don't?
Don't.
Don't like him. Okay. Right?
I watched him a few times.
A little kind of crazy there, right?
Does he not have a degree? I have heard that he does not have a degree in his expertise.
Yeah, I have no idea. I have no idea. I know that Dr. Seuss never actually had a doctor degree. He just decided to. Yeah.
I believed him before I was.
Yeah. Let's go back a couple of years. Dear Abby, did you ever read Dear Abby, Norlene?
I suppose so.
Yeah. What's your take on Dear Abby? Does she seem like a pretty reasonable person?
I don't know. I haven't even thought about her in a long time.
Okay. Okay.
A lot of things that she said had a lot of common sense to it.
Okay. Oh, I'm sorry, I left an R off of that.
Yeah, I was wondering if she belonged to the DEA.
Yeah, I know. Whenever we're on a trip, this is the one we listen to. Dr. Laura?
She's not a doctor.
I don't know nothing about
it. Most people don't know who she is out
here. Okay, good.
Yeah, so.
If you think your life is screwed up, listen to about 10 minutes of Dr. Laura, and your life is pretty normal. Because there's a lot of other screwed up people that call into that. Maybe this is somebody that somebody here will recognize.
Tell me about Glenn Beck. What do you think?
A little over the edge.
How do you mean he's a little over the edge?
He's kind of out there. Kind of like out the field. Out in left field.
Yeah, that's the scary thing with Glenn Beck is that he's more right. He's right more times than he isn't. Crazy stuff. Yeah. Now here's what I want to say. Watch what Paul says here. The intelligence of the intelligent. Where is the wise? Where is the teacher of the law? The philosopher of this age? Has God not made them foolish? Right now, I have my oldest. Just a second. My oldest is eating, breathing, bleeding Dave Ramsey stuff these days. And which the good thing is he's eliminated almost $7,000 worth of debt in the last 31 days, which I thought was pretty cool. But the other crazy thing is that
in the middle one already.
Say that.
In the middle one already done. Or...
Oh yeah, middle one's already ahead of all of us. Golly. When he retires, it'll make Warren Buffett look like a poor man. I don't know. Maybe not. But here's the strange thing. There's a lot of advice that we have out in our world, and it's peddled as advice. A number of years ago, the church that I was in, we were going through redoing our library. And what we did in our library is they made a whole section of books that were called self-help books. Maybe you've read a self-help book a time or two. And you start going out and doing those things. Has anybody ever read and done something in a self-help book that was not the best idea? Have you ever experienced anything like that? I'm real leery. Just me. I'm real leery of self-help books. Because while it sounds really good, and it may actually work, here's what we're trying to do, I think, is that we're trying to somehow fix ourselves and our brokenness. And this is a hard teaching here. For since in the wisdom of God, the world through its wisdom did not know him. Verse 21 is strange. God designed us that no matter how wise we are, you cannot know God through your wisdom. Does that make sense? We cannot know God through our wisdom.
You're not being able to prove him. You don't have any proof that he exists.
Explain that. Robert, let's dig that out.
It's like a mathematical equation or situation or geometry type thing. You prove this theorem and it proves that. Nothing about God are you able to prove it if you don't have faith. Is that right?
Wait, you can't prove it if you don't have faith.
And then, well, I mean, it's not a provable item. We can see.
No one living has ever seen it.
Or have we? Okay, I got 10 minutes to lay this case out, because this is where we get crazy here. Anybody know what 4/3 pi r cubed is? Volume of a sphere. Laura gets to start today. Yeah, you're right. Yeah. I have a set of calculations written down on a card in the wall of my office about how do you figure out two points that are on a sphere as the sphere is expanding. So here's time section one, here's time section two. And it's a whole lot more complex than this, okay? I'm not gonna write it down because it's absolutely stupid. But it gets its parameters out of this. The reason this is important is if we live in an expanding universe, how far are we from here to Mars may be different than how far we are from here to Mars 30 years from now. And it helps calculate, oh hey, and physicists have to kind of keep this stuff in mind as we're gonna send something to Mars here pretty soon. How do we get there? Does an inch matter? Yeah, maybe not, but it may matter in a long time. Now, here's the crazy thing. We can figure out the volume of a sphere, 4/3 pi r cubed, and we can call that intelligence, we can call that wisdom, we can call it whatever it is that we want to. This, being able to measure it, doesn't tell us anything about the creator of the sphere. Like what Robert was saying, how can we prove God? This is about the only way I have been able to, and it's just me, because I worry about this stuff. Time exists. And I think, because time exists, that's about the only thing I've got for a provable theorem on can you prove that God exists. It's a long way to get there, I know. But would time exist if God somehow didn't create it? The reason I say that is the foundation of Genesis 1:1. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Seems somehow that before the heavens and the earth, we have an in the beginning. Okay? And because time exists, I think that's the only way we can really start jumping into does God exist? Is figuring out this thing called time. And that creates a whole nother set of problems. It's just bonkers where you go from there. But all of this is theoretical, all of this is philosophical, all of this is interpolated. God said, you can try to figure this out all you want to. If this is true, if time exists, is that a proof for God? This is bothersome because watch what it says here. For since the wisdom of God, the world through its wisdom did not know him, and God was pleased through the foolishness of what was preached to save those who believe. So Jews demand signs. Jews demand signs. And Greeks look for wisdom. It's kind of interesting that this was illustrated without me having to do anything. Because of Curtis. You brought out that there was a cross with a 50-foot circle around it. Wasn't burned in the middle of the fires. Watch this. Oh my goodness, that's a sign. Me, I'm thinking, well, maybe they just went out and watered that spot a lot. I don't know. You give me a sign, and I totally, very seldom phases me. There's some things that this is very real for people. I've had conversations, and I walk away, it's like, this is what your preacher says. I'm not nuts. They might be, but I'm not. And then this is what happens with your pastor. Your pastor says, oh, time exists. And you guys walk out here, it's like, my goodness, our pastor's nuts. God, I'm not, but he's nuts. And so there's something here inherent with each of us, that we will lean on signs, or we will lean on wisdom. We will try to figure this out. And if we can figure this out, all is good. All is good with the world because we figured it out. And God said, you know what? All this stuff that you try to figure out through signs, through math, through all this other stuff, guess what? It's completely nonsense. I think God gave us clues. Because here's one we'll walk away with. Some of you today will walk away with, holy cow, that cross that wasn't burned in the middle of the field, that's a sign that God knows what he's doing. And some of you may walk away today saying, you know what, I kind of figured a little bit more out today about God. God knows what he's doing. But neither one of these things can actually do anything. Watch this. It is the foolishness of this. Jews demand signs, Greeks look for wisdom, but we preach what? Verse 23. Christ crucified. All of this stuff is irrelevant because Jesus was on the cross. And a burnt cross in the field, or an unburnt cross in the field, doesn't mean anything. Time existing doesn't mean anything. Paul is saying the only thing that means anything is Jesus died for you on a cross.
And he rebuked the disciples after resurrection?
For their unbelief. Exactly. Mark 16. Yeah. It's like, guys, I've tried to explain this to you. I've told you three times. You guys have quit, you guys hiding out. You get off your cans. Gee whiz. Here it is. But to those whom God has called, both Jews and Greeks, how is Christ described here in verse 24?
Power of God.
He's the power of God.
And the wisdom of God.
The foolishness of God is wiser than human wisdom, and the weakness of God is stronger than human strength. The reason that the cross becomes venerated, the reason the crucifixion matters, is that it answers both the intelligence and the mind or the heart here in this. I'm going to go one step further. This is the international sign for car. I don't care what kind of car it is, it's just a car, right? Has anybody here ever had a car that decided one day that it would no longer function? Less for kicks and giggles, what was wrong with the car and it wouldn't function properly? What have you ever done to a car or had a wreck? What?
Worn out.
What? But let's, like, I want to say, what specifically broke?
Battery
died. Okay.
Out of gas.
No gas.
The motor.
What happened to the motor?
I don't know. Right. I don't know because I'm not good at that.
Gotcha. See, there we go.
The guys were working on it one day and it stopped working again.
Yep.
Transmission.
Fuel pump. I was rebuilding a race car engine with my friend when I was racing, and I dropped a nut through one of the spark plug holes. And he was so nice, he took about a 30-minute walk around the block, didn't say anything to me. I had to sit there and pull the stuff apart and get the nut out of the piston cylinder.
That's pretty talented, though, to drop a nut.
Thank you, dear. Thank you for reminding me that.
You need a crutch for you?
Yeah. See, Harry, she says I'm talented. Harry's like, dude, you're stupid. Don't do that. It's like, yeah, well, thank you.
You get it out?
Yeah, but here's the thing. Some things... I'm just using a different color.
How did you get it out? That's what I'm going
to
ask.
I had to disassemble the head.
Why?
That's why
I had to, yeah. I had to take the intake off and
why?
The... Because
I could have got it out without doing anything.
Well, you weren't there.
You just need a magnet. Go in that hole and bring it up with a magnet.
Did I get that close? Fix it yourself? Yeah. It's already done. I can't change it. I'm just telling you what I did. I actually had to go fix it myself, right? Had to go fix it myself because it was broken.
Because I've dropped bolts down the carburetor and that's how I've got them out.
Yeah, well, sometimes we can do that. Here's what I...
Called up.
See, you guys are worried about the engine. You're missing the point. Curtis, I want to get... He's going to call me up this afternoon. Larry, if you would, just like, yeah. Curtis, I love you. And that's the way I need you here for these things. But this is what I want to communicate. As we get ready for this next section, that's apparently now going to be next week. We approach life as either we have to fix it ourselves, and we can do it. We can get a we can do tons of different things to fix it ourselves. We can get it done. The difference is here, is that in our natural brokenness, the only thing that can fix it is not our wisdom, it's not our eloquence, it's not how much we know about God or all the different proofs. It's that the cross fixes us. This here is the only thing that can fix us. And here's the hard thing. Do you believe that? That somehow Jesus dying on a cross and coming back to life fixes us? Because that's the essence of faith. More about that in the sermon coming up.
Coming up. Stay tuned.
Let me pray. Father God, we thank you that it's not about how smart we are, how wise we are, or, you know,
we somehow get some indications that you're there. But we all as individuals see our own things that we want to see. Father, we just need you. We just need to see you. Your son Jesus at the cross, that this is how you just decided to show yourself to the world. Nothing else matters but the fact that your son died for us on a cross and rose again. It is the heart of what we do, whether it's in communion or at the worship service, we focus on Jesus and the cross and the resurrection. And Father, we hear it. Sometimes we miss out on your power because we think we believe it, but it's different when it comes into the heart. Father God, we got our own challenges. We've all seen it this week. And we can't fix it. And the more strength and the more effort and the more stuff we put into trying to fix problems ourselves can just aggravate the situation. Father, what fixed it is your son on the cross. Fix our brokenness through your power, not through preaching, not through wisdom and eloquence and all this other stuff. But the only thing that can fix it is Jesus. Change our hearts. Let us trust fully in him. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Mm-hmm.